Fundamentals of software testing approaches and techniques. So far we have been discussing we have approaches like a dynamic program is being run, and static, which means inspections rather than running the software. Besides these, there are of course others, such as white box or glass box or clear box testing, black box testing, and gray box testing. Let's go through these. So, white box or glass box testing, it means that the tester knows the internal structure of the system. That means that she has access to the source code. And this enables testing of every if-else combination. So if you have a software that would have a lot of variation whether a user is inputting what. So if we know the source code, we can test basically every combination. And the tester can also utilize tools describing the states and values of variables. You can have debug prints, you can have breakpoints, you can get the value of some kind of a variables, these kind of things when you have access to the source code. So as the tester has access to internal structure, she also knows what she's doing, and at least this should be the case. So in that sense, the tester needs to know the software architecture and the programming. And so if she is not familiar with programming at all, then she cannot do white box testing. And this is usually relevant in unit testing level. So unit testing is something that is very white box related. So here we have a picture. So we have the system here. It's inside white box. We know what is going on here, and we can then input some data to the system and we get some output, and then the output is compared to the specs, and if the output matches the required output, then the test has been accepted. Test passes. Then we have a black box testing. Tester testing the system without any knowing of the internal structure. This is the traditional way to do software testing. So it's just test it. You just press button and check what happens when you have been pressing it. So basically, tester gives inputs to the system and validates the output. Black box testing can be utilized in almost any phase of the software development. It's very simple and it's seasoned approach. Still, it is used more in the system and acceptance testing phases. As the white box testing was very good in unit testing, then the black box testing is good in system testing. And the tester does not need to understand the system structure or architecture. He or she doesn't even have to know how to program. Tester can be non-programmer in for example in acceptance testing. But of course in some testing cases the programming skills are beneficial. So in here the system is just a black box. You don't know what happens inside it. You put data in and you get data out, and then you just comparing to specs, but you don't know what in the system is what's happens inside the box. Gray box testing, it combines features from white box and black box testing. The tester has a partial knowledge of the internal structure, such as documentation of data structures and algorithms. Testers need to have understanding on the programming level and also in the high level how the system functions. And gray box testing is suitable, for example, on cases where whole system cannot be tested with white box testing. There is so much to test. So if we have millions of lines of code and we are doing integration testing, then it probably cannot be done with the white box approach. And of course, when we have a system that has a lot of third-party components, which internal structure is not available, we have only an APIs, we can use closed source components or web APIs that, for example, some Facebook API. We don't know how it's programmed, but we know what we can do it with, what kind of calls we can create, and what kind of data we should get back. So not everything can be tested with the same approach. Or even if it could be, it's definitely not wise. And the next table is an approximation on what approaches are suitable in what phases. So we have a static, white box, gray box, and black box testing. And then we have a unit integration, system acceptance, usability, and regression testing. We could have even more here if we wanted, but in this table we have just these. So white box is used here in a low level in unit testing and basically also a bit in integration testing. And then we go upper and upper, and we are using more and more black box testing. In acceptance testing, the customer is accepting also manuals, support, and these kind of things. They are used with static testing in inspections, and in with the regression testing, it depends what we are testing. We can use all of these approaches. Then about testing techniques, there are dozens and dozens of concrete testing techniques to help to find the issues with software or its design. We are not going through all of them. You could find, let's say, 100 of those, but let's go through a few of them. A/B testing, debugging, mutation testing, boundary value analysis, prototype testing, test-driven development, and soft clones. A/B testing. So usually used in a usability testing. We have a user interface version A, and then we have a user interface version B. Which one is better? Version A could have different colors, bigger font, or otherwise different layout, and then we have comparing it to version B. And we could have a Android user interface and iPhone user interface, and then comparing those basically with API testing. Users can give direct feedback, so they are telling that, oh, I like more of this version B. Or indirect, which would be from logs. So we have a web page that is given randomly different user interface, and then on the logs we can see that the user interface version B was used much more than we would prefer the user interface version B. Facebook utilizes this heavily, as we were discussing previously, that they have thousands of different versions of their website running all the time. So there is A, B, C, D, F, G versions, and you can get data from logs basically that version C is the best, and then go further with it. A/B testing can also be used to test business model, especially revenue streams with different presentation of paid content. So free-to-play mobile game can utilize different, let's say, diamond advertising to different gamers. So some could have, let's say, 10 minutes to buy 100 diamonds with 100 euros, and then the other group could get 1 hour to spend 60 euros to buy 6,000 diamonds or something like that. And then the game developers see that, okay, this diamond advertising was better than this other one, so let's use that. There are a lot of ethical issues with this kind of game things, but that's another story. Debugging or fault seeding or error seeding. So the idea is to seed faults in the source code, then test the software and count how many seeded faults were found, and thus extrapolate how many bugs are still left. What does it mean? So we, for example, seed 10 new bugs to the source code, and testers test the software then, and then they find 72 of those, and then they find 163 other bugs that were not seeded there. Then we can calculate that the total number of bugs divided by found other bugs is equals to seeded total bugs divided by seeded found bugs. And here the found other is this 163, seeded total is 100, and seeded found is 72. And if we then calculate, the bugs total is 226. And of course, this is just an estimation, but you can use this kind of formula. It's much better than Stetson Harrison, but it's still just an estimate. Yeah, so then there can be some problems with this debugging thing. For example, what if the seeded bugs remain in code that is brought to production? That's something that is very, very bad. Of course, when you are debugging and testing the software, it should be done in a testing environment that has nothing to do with the code in the production environment. And how much seeded bugs produced other found bugs? So you are seeding 100 bugs, but it could just be that they create other bugs indirectly, so these things should be considered when using this method. Mutation testing. Similar to debugging, program is modified in small ways, and these mutant versions are then tested. And the aim is to estimate the effectiveness of testing. So this is a way to estimate the testing. Did all the mutants got killed? So that's one way. If the testing is one way to one thing to calculate if all the mutants got killed, so then the testing is successful. But also, are there test cases that do not kill mutants at all? Why we have those test cases? Are they irrelevant at all? So those test cases be removed. Fast testing similar to mutation testing. In this case, the data used by the software is fast. For example, program expects to get int value from external API, but it gets JSON dump. Then what happens then? Boundary value analysis. It's a testing technique where testing is focusing on boundary values, which can become problematic. So, for example, heavy simplification. If we have a 16-bit unsigned integer, So it can have values from from 0 to 65,535, which is 2.16 minus 1. In this case, the boundary values are 0 and 65,535. And what happens near these boundary values is important. There probably are no errors when the value is 100 or 1000, but if the value is 0 and it's then minus 1 from 0 is then 65,000. So it's that can be the problematic thing. And when program ends up to invalid area, test cases should point out these, and the program should be developed further to handle this issue. Prototype testing. Prototypes are used especially when testing user interfaces, but of course they can be used also test some other things. So when developing a prototype, it is usual to cut corners. Instead of database, JSON is just dumped to a file, not written to database. Secure communication is not thought, it's just plain text is communicated through clients or something like that. Prototypes can be given to a customer to be tested, and it seems that customers they are like it's easier to describe what to improve than what completely new is needed. So if you are showing some kind of a prototype or even final product, customer can describe that this needs to be changed and there is room for improvement and this is not working. But if you are giving them just an empty paper and describe perfect user interface, it's much harder to do that. And when we are talking about computer game companies, they can easily test whether some idea has potential to become a full game or not. You make a proof of concept game based on prototyping. And some ideas are better in paper than as software. And for example, a few years back, there was group I was involved in Finnish Game Jam, and we were creating this game called Konnari Karhu. The original idea was very good, but it ended up to be become a horrible disaster. You might find something in YouTube and in Google if you are brave enough. And some software are better than ideas on paper. For example, spreadsheet. I think it was developed in 80s, 1980s, and the original idea that someone would want to have a spreadsheet in computer screen where she could input some numbers and get numbers out. It didn't sound that important, but in the end, excellent. Its rivals are very, very used and important pieces of software. Test-driven development. So in test-driven development, TDD, tests are written before the actual code. This is very important. Thus, the tests exist and they have to be passed before the program is ready. So you just cannot forget those tests. They have to be there. And there is also this idea that the actual code is written only once after the test. You could write a code, then test to it, and run the test, and the test fails, and then you need to modify the code, the actual code. But if you write the test first, then you just can concentrate on the code writing. And the test-driven development was introduced in the beginning of this millennium, and it's very widely used and pretty important thing in agile software development and software industry as a whole. How does this work? So first you add a test, you write a new test, then you run all the tests or at least the new test to see that the new test fails. The test is not good if it's if passes without the actual code. So the test needs to fail. Then you are writing the code, and then you're running the test again to see whether the test is passed or failed. If the test probably is failing somehow, then you refactor the code and run a test again, and etc. And then you go to the next iteration to add some new features. Soft launch, just short testing software with limited number of customers. That's the idea. So you are, this is very much related to mobile games. And a game is launched only in some countries, e.g. in Canada or Finland. And if the Canadian audience is liking the game, then you can release it otherwise. So when you launch it in Canada, you're collecting data, how the gamers are playing it. Are they using money? If this is a free-to-play game, and after data is being collected, the game can be improved. Or if it's horribly not success, then it's just discarded. It's very much a similar technique than beta testing, but used especially with mobile games. Then just completely other thing, this bug severity level. It has been discussed a bit before, but let's dive a bit deeper. Bug severity can be divided, for example, minor, major, and critical, which was mentioned before. This is very suitable if we have a small development. We are development, for example, some small web pages to a company that is farming carrots or something like that. Then there can be minor issues, major issues, or critical issues. But if we are working with a more complex project, such as a nuclear power plant embedded operating system, then this minor, major, critical is not enough. And more levels and more definitions are required. There is no standard scaling, but for example, the following could be used in this case. Level zero, there is just small fall that is irritating user, so we can have a wrong color in some button. It's still working, but the user is irritating. Level one, insignificant or small final loss. So the system is still working, but some customers do not want to use it, but 99% want to use it, so there is not that much loss. Level 2, significant financial loss. Let's say only 60% of the customers want to use the system, so you are really losing money. Level 3, unbearable financial loss or operating or person dependent on the system becoming disabled. So the nuclear power plant has buttons that make the power plant to leak some radioactive thing, and that's not good for your health, so someone is becoming disabled. Or then there is level 4. There is a button that makes the whole nuclear power plant explode, so then there is a very, very critical bug that needs to be fixed. As a conclusion, various testing techniques exist, and some are more suitable for some tasks and the other to other tasks. So you always need to check what's the best one for this task. There are white box, black box, and gray box testing approaches. They are very used in every phase of software development. Some are more suitable for some phases and other to other phases. always need to think about what's the best. A lot can be automated with right tools and courage to lean forward.